Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs.
The Half-Life of Facts: Why Everything We Know Has an Expiration Date, by Samuel Arbesman. Narrated by Sean Pratt. Chapter 1. The Half-Life of Facts. When my grandfather was in dental school in the late 1930s, he was taught state-of-the-art medical knowledge. He learned all about anatomy, many aspects of biochemistry, and cell biology. He was also taught the number of chromosomes in a human cell. The problem was, he learned that it was 48. Biologists had first visualized the nuclei of human cells in 1912 and counted these 48 chromosomes, and it was duly entered into the textbooks. In 1953, a well-known cytologist, someone who studies the interior of cells, even said that the diploid chromosome number of 48 in man can now be considered an established fact. But in 1956, Jo Hin Chio and Albert Levan, two researchers working at Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center in New York and the Cancer Chromosome Laboratory in Sweden, decided to try a recently created technique for looking at cells. After counting over and over, they nearly always got only 46 chromosomes. Previous researchers, who Chio and Levan spoke with after receiving their results, turned out to have been having similar problems. These other scientists had even stopped some of their work prematurely because they could only find 46 out of the 48 chromosomes that they knew had to be there. But Chio and Levan didn't make the same assumption. Instead, they made the bold suggestion that everyone else had been using the wrong number. There are only 46 chromosomes in a human cell. Facts change all the time. Smoking has gone from doctor recommended to deadly. Meat used to be good for you, then bad to eat, then good again. Now, it's a matter of opinion. The age at which women are told to get mammograms has increased. We used to think that the Earth was the center of the universe and our planet has since been demoted. I have no idea any longer whether red wine is good for me. And to take another familial example, my father, a dermatologist, told me about a multiple-choice exam he took in medical school that included the same question 2 years in a row. The answer choices remained exactly the same, but 1 year the answer was one choice, and the next year it was a different one. Other types of facts, ones about our surroundings, also change. The average internet connection is far faster now than it was 10 years ago. The language of science has gone from Latin to German to English, and is certain to change again. Humanity has progressed from a population of less than 2 billion to more than 7 billion people in the past 100 years alone. We have gone from being earthbound to having had humans walk on the moon, and we have sent our artifacts beyond the boundaries of our solar system. Chess, checkers, and even Jeopardy have gone from being the domains of human experts to ones of computerized mastery. Our world seems to be in constant flux. With our knowledge changing all the time, even the most informed people can barely keep up. All this change may seem random and overwhelming. Dinosaurs have feathers? When did that happen? But it turns out there is actually order within the shifting noise. This order is regular and systematic, and is one that can be described by science and mathematics. Knowledge is like radioactivity. If you look at a single atom of uranium, whether it's going to decay, breaking down, and unleashing its energy, is highly unpredictable. It might decay in the next second, or you might have to sit and stare at it for thousands, or perhaps even millions of years before it breaks apart. But when you take a chunk of uranium, itself made up of trillions upon trillions of atoms, suddenly the unpredictable becomes predictable. We know how uranium atoms work in the aggregate. As a group of atoms, uranium is highly regular. When we combine particles together, a rule of probability known as the law of large numbers takes over, and even the behavior of a tiny piece of uranium becomes understandable. If we are patient enough, half of a chunk of uranium will break down in 704 million years, like clockwork. This number, 704 million years, is a measurable amount of time and is known as the half-life of uranium. It turns out that facts, when viewed as a large body of knowledge, are just as predictable. Facts in the aggregate have half-lives. We can measure the amount of time for half of a subject's knowledge to be overturned. There is science that explores the rates at which new facts are created, new technologies are developed, and even how facts spread. How knowledge changes can be understood scientifically. This is a powerful idea. We don't have to be at sea in a world of changing knowledge. Instead, we can understand how facts grow and change in the aggregate, just like radioactive materials. This book is a guide to the startling notion that our knowledge, even what each of us has in our head, changes in understandable and systematic ways. How exactly is knowing how knowledge changes actually useful? You may find it interesting to discover that the dinosaurs of our youth, slow reptilian and gray-green, are now fast-moving, covered in feathers, and the colors of the NBC peacock. But if you don't have a 6-year-old at home, this is probably not going to affect your life in any significant way. I could tell you that certain areas of medical knowledge have a churn of less than a half century, well within a single lifespan. And knowing this can motivate us to constantly brush up on what we know so we continue to eat healthy or exercise correctly and don't simply rely on what we were told when we were young. Or I could say that by knowing how language changes, we can better understand the slang and dialect of the generation that follows us. But really, practical examples like these, while important, medical knowledge will keep cropping up, are not the main point. Knowing how facts change, how knowledge spreads, or how we adapt to new ideas are all important for a different reason. Knowing how knowledge works can help us make sense of our world. And even more than that, it can allow us to anticipate the shortcomings in what we each might know and help us to plan for these flaws in our knowledge. Facts are how we organize and interpret our surroundings. No one learns something new and then holds it entirely independent of what they already know. We incorporate it into the little edifice of personal knowledge that we have been creating in our minds our entire lives. In fact, we even have a phrase for the state of affairs that occurs when we fail to do this. Cognitive dissonance. Ordering our surroundings is the rule of how we as humans operate. In childhood, we give names to our toys, and in adulthood, we give names to our species, chemical elements, asteroids, and cities. By naming, or more broadly, by categorizing, we are creating an order to an otherwise chaotic and frightening world. And when we learn facts, we are doing the same thing. Facts, whether about our surroundings, the current state of knowledge, or even ourselves, provide us with a sense of control and a sense of comfort. When we see something out of the corners of our eyes around dusk, we needn't view it as a creepy bird of the night. We call that a bat, which is a winged nocturnal mammal that sees through the use of echolocation and is probably afraid of the bipedal mammals around it. Only half as scary, right? But when facts change, we lose a little bit of this control. Suddenly, things aren't quite as they seemed. If doctors didn't know that smoking was bad for us for decades, we worry about what else doctors are also wrong about today. If I've just learned that my parents had completely different, and for their time acceptable, parenting techniques for my own, I am a bit concerned about my upbringing. And if I've just found out that scientists have discovered hundreds of planets outside the solar system, and I was living with the assumption that there were only a handful, I might be a little shaken, or at the very least somewhat surprised. But if we can understand the underlying order and patterns of how facts change, we can better handle all of the uncertainty that's around us. To be clear, I'm using the word fact in an intuitive way, a bit of knowledge that we know, either as individuals or as a society, as something about the state of the world. We generally like our facts to represent an accurate representation of reality, an objective truth, but that's not always the case. Certain fields use fact to mean an objective truth. The endeavor of science gets us ever closer to this truth, and many of the shifts in what we know occur only at the fringes of discovery, and are due to our continuous approach to the truth. However, I am choosing to use fact in a looser fashion, simply to refer to our individual states of knowledge awareness. This can refer to a scientific fact, even if it might eventually be disproved, or even to a less ambiguous sort of fact, such as the current fastest human runner or the most powerful computer, which are facts about our surroundings. This will not satisfy everyone, but there are two reasons for this choice. The first is to avoid being drawn down some sort of epistemological rabbit hole, which is likely to be more than a little confusing. To paraphrase Justice Potter Stewart, many of us know a fact when we see one. But second, and more important, it turns out, that lots of different types of knowledge change in similar ways. While some facts are about approaching truth and some are about our changing surroundings, we can only see the similarities clearly in how they operate by bundling all of these types of facts together. And there's one simple way to organize facts, even before we understand all the math and science behind how knowledge changes. We can organize what we know by the rate at which it changes. Imagine we have all the facts in the world, those pieces of knowledge that contain all that we know, lined up according to how often they change. On the far left, we have the fast-changing facts, the ones that are constantly in flux. These are things such as what the weather will be tomorrow, or what the stock market close was yesterday. And on the far right, we have the very slow-changing facts, the ones that, for all practical purposes, are constant. These are facts such as the number of continents on the planet or the number of fingers on a human hand. In between, we have the facts that change, but not too quickly, and are therefore that much more maddening to deal with. These facts might change over the course of years or decades or a single lifetime. How many billions of people are on the planet is one of these. I learned 5 billion in school, and we just recently crossed 7 billion as of 2012. My grandfather, who was born in 1917, learned there were fewer than 2 billion. The number of planets outside the solar system that have been discovered, or, for that matter, the number of planets in our own solar system, is also in this category. What we know about dinosaurs is in this group of facts, as is the average speed of a computer. The vast majority of what we know seems to fall into this category, which I call mesofacts, facts that change at the meso or middle timescale. Lots of our scientific knowledge consists of mesofacts. For example, the number of known chemical elements is a mesofact. If, as a baby boomer, you learned high school chemistry in 1970, and then, as we all are apt to do, did not take care to brush up on your chemistry periodically, you would not realize that there are at least 12 new elements in the periodic table, bringing the total up to 118. Over a tenth of the elements have been discovered since you graduated high school. And all that dinosaur knowledge I've mentioned is also made up of mesofacts. Technology is full of mesofacts, too. from the increase in transportation speeds to the changes in how we store information, from floppy disk to the cloud. The height of the tallest skyscraper has also steadily increased over time due to improving technology. World records are constantly being broken in the realms of human ability, and we recently have begun to be humbled by machines as they rack up wins against us in more and more games once deemed too complex for computers, from Othello and checkers to chess. All mesofacts. Mesofacts are all around us, and just acknowledging their existence is useful. It can help eliminate part of the surprise in our lives. If my grandfather had been told in dental school that a specific fraction of the knowledge he learned there would become obsolete soon after he graduated, this could at least provide an anchor for his uncertainty. It would prevent dentists of his generation from being surprised by basic biological facts or from working with outdated knowledge. In fact, many medical schools now do this. They embrace the mesofacts of medicine, teaching physicians that changing knowledge is the rule rather than the exception. But simply knowing that knowledge changes like this isn't enough. We would end up going a little crazy as we frantically tried to keep up with the ever-changing facts around us, forever living on some sort of informational treadmill. But it doesn't have to be this way, because there are patterns. Facts change in regular and mathematically understandable ways, and only by knowing the pattern of our knowledge's evolution can we be better prepared for its change. There are mathematical regularities behind the headlines of changing scientific knowledge. We accumulate scientific knowledge like clockwork, with the result that facts are overturned at regular intervals in our quest to better understand the world. Similarly, the growth and change of technological knowledge, from processing power to information storage, are also part of the universe of facts that change with regularity. And of course, these two areas, science and technology, affect many other factual aspects of our lives, from the spread of disease, to how we travel, and even to the increase in computer viruses on the internet. All of these areas of knowledge change systematically. But just as the creation of facts operates according to certain scientific principles, so too does the spread of knowledge, how each of us hears of new information, or how error gets dispelled, adheres to the rules of mathematics. And due to a new understanding of cognitive biases, much of what each of us knows, even as it changes, now has a clear structure. These shifts obey certain scientific patterns that are explicable by findings in cognitive science. This is not to say that we can understand everything. Much in the world is shocking and unexpected, and we still have to deal with these new facts when we become aware of them. But by and large, there are ways to understand how our knowledge changes, ways to bring order to the chaos of ever-changing facts. William McNeill Dixon, a British professor of literature in the late 19th and early 20th centuries, once wrote, "The facts of the present won't sit still for a portrait. They are constantly vibrating, full of clutter and confusion." We now understand how vibrations work due to physics. We're no longer confused by the fact that plucking a guitar string somehow gives rise to order and music. It's time we do the same thing for the fluctuations in what we know as well, and recognize that there's an order to all of our changing knowledge. This book is a guide to the science behind the vibrations in the facts around us. Chapter 2. The Pace of Discovery. When Derek J. De Sola Price arrived at Raffles College, now the National University of Singapore, to lecture on applied mathematics in 1947, he did not intend to spearhead an entirely new way of looking at science. But his plans to continue research in physics and mathematics were altered by the construction on the college library. Since Raffles was a small university, the library was actually giving books out to students and faculty to store in their dormitories and apartments while the construction was underway. Price ended up with a complete set of Philosophical Transactions of the Royal Society of London, a British scientific journal that dates back to 1665. Once home, he stacked the journals chronologically against the walls in his apartment. Each pile was published later than the one before it, and they were all lined up one after another. One day, while idly looking at this large collection of books that the library had foisted upon him, he realized that the heights of the piles of these bound volumes weren't all the same. But their heights weren't random, either. Instead, he realized, the heights of the volumes fit a specific mathematical shape. An exponential curve. Price's simple observation was the origin of a sophisticated quantitative theory for how scientific knowledge advances. Most of our everyday lives revolve around linear growth, or changes that can be fit onto a line. When something increases by the same amount each year, when the rate is constant, we get linear growth. When we drive somewhere and go at the same speed the entire way, a chart showing the distance we've traveled over time follows a straight line. And if we have a machine that builds widgets at a constant rate of 3 per hour, the number of widgets after a given number of hours grows linearly with the number of hours we're considering. Due to how easy it is to imagine, and our brains seem particularly well-suited to this type of thinking, we often think in terms of linear growth. If the temperature was 65 degrees yesterday, and 60 degrees the day before that, it is not surprising if we expect it to be about 70 degrees today. But there are many examples of change that occur differently. If you were watching when the sun set over the course of a few days early in the summer, it wouldn't be unreasonable to expect the sunset's timing to follow a nice linear curve. Each day the sun sets the same number of minutes later than it did the day before. But it turns out that sunsets at a specific location adhere to a sine curve, a wave-like shape that looks like a rope being shaken up and down, a shape that we aren't particularly intuitive about. During the solstices, the shortest and longest days of the year, we are at the top or bottom of the wave, when the sunset only varies by a small amount each day. During the equinoxes, spring and fall, we are in the steep parts of the wave, and each day the sunset time is many minutes different from the day before. This is far from a curve that we can think about easily. We are just as ill-suited when it comes to noticing the many changes that adhere to exponential growth. When we encounter exponential curves all around us, we often don't think about it this way at all, because it is harder to picture. Exponential growth is when something increases by the same fraction or percentage, rather than the same amount, each second or minute or hour. If bacteria double every hour, that's exponential growth, because they're growing at a constant rate of 200% an hour. Compound interest is the same sort of thing. If our money grows by a certain percentage each year, we can describe this growth by an exponential curve. As you might have realized, exponential growth is very rapid. Even if we are initially adding only a small amount to some quantity each hour or day, that quantity can become very big very quickly. Imagine we are given a penny and begin doubling it each day. After a week, we would be receiving less than $1.50 a day. But give it one more week. Now we're getting more than $80 a day. Within a month, our allowance is more than $100 million a day. Exponential growth gets its name from the use of an exponent. An exponent signifies how many times to multiply another number, the base, by itself. Many times a special constant is used for the base. In the case of exponential growth, it is often denoted by the letter E. Also known as Napier's constant, it is about 2.72. It's one of those numbers, like pi, that crops up in the weirdest situations, from bacteria doubling to infinitely long sums of numbers. The exponent part of the equation includes what is known as its rate of growth. The larger this value, the faster the quantity grows, and the faster it doubles. The exponential growth curve was well known to Price. So when he began to measure the heights of his stacks of journals, he knew immediately what was going on. But maybe he just happened to have gotten the only stack of journals that obeyed this curious pattern. So he began collecting lots of data, a research style that he followed throughout his life. He measured the number of journal articles in the physics literature in general, as well as for more specialized fields, such as the subfield that deals with linear algebra. And they all seemed to have elements of the exponential curve. Price began to recognize that this could be a new way to think about how science grows and develops. Price published his findings, under the title Quantitative Measures of the Development of Science, in a small French journal in 1951, after presenting this work at a conference the previous year in Amsterdam. No one was interested. But Price wasn't deterred. He returned to Cambridge and continued to pursue his research in this new field, the quantitative study of science, or scientometrics, as it soon became known. This science of science was still quite young, but Price set himself to collecting vast quantities of data to help him understand how science changes. By the 1960s, he was the foremost authority in this field. He gathered data from all aspects of science and marshaled evidence that enabled him to look at scientific growth as something far from haphazard. This knowledge was subject to regular laws. Expanding on his initial research on scientific journals, he gathered data for a wide variety of areas that displayed this growth, from chemistry to astronomy. Price calculated the doubling times, that is, how long it takes for something to double, a proportional increase that implies exponential growth, for those components of science and technology, which then can be used as a rough metric for seeing how different types of facts change over time. Here is a selection of these doubling times from his 1963 book, Little Science, Big Science. Under the domain of Number of Entries in a Dictionary of National Biography, the doubling time in years is 100. In the domain of Number of Universities, the doubling time in years is 50. For the domain of the Number of Important Discoveries, Number of Chemical Elements Known, and Accuracy of Instruments, their doubling time in years is 20. In the domains of Number of Scientific Journals, Number of Chemical Compounds Known, and Memberships of Scientific Institutes, the doubling time in years is 15. And finally, in the domains of Number of Asteroids Known and Number of Engineers in the United States, the doubling time in years is 10. The growth of facts was finally beginning to be subjected to the rigors of mathematics. Parallel to Price's work in the hard sciences, a similar line of research was proceeding in the social sciences. In 1947, a psychologist named Harvey Lehman published a curious little paper in the journal Social Forces. Combing through a wide variety of dictionaries, encyclopedias, and chronologies, Lehman set out to count the number of major contributions made in a wide variety of areas of study over the years. He looked at everything from genetics and math to the arts, whether new scientific findings, new theorems, or even new operas produced. What he found in all of these were exponential increases in output over time. But this wasn't only over the previous few decades. Lehman looked at each of these areas over hundreds of years. He examined philosophy over the 600 years from 1275 to 1875, botany over the 300 years from 1600 to 1900, and geology over the 400 years from 1500 to 1900. Each area was found to have a characteristic rate of increase. Here are doubling times, that is, the number of years it takes for the yearly contributions in these fields to double, from Lehman's findings, along with a few more recent areas examined. In the field of medicine and hygiene, 87 years. For the field of philosophy, 77 years. Mathematics, 63 years. Geology, 46 years. Entomology, 39 years. Chemistry, 35 years. Genetics, 32 years. And Grand Opera, 20 years. Independently, a number of thinkers were coming to the realization that the growth of knowledge was subject to patterns and was far from random. Similarly, different types of growth fit different types of knowledge creation. For example, opera is a far faster changing domain than the sciences. Even though science and opera composition are inherently creative, science is limited by what we can determine about nature. Science can develop only as quickly as we can figure out things about the world. Grand opera, however, is not limited by what is true, only by what is beautiful, and should therefore be able to grow more rapidly since it doesn't have to be rigorously subjected to experimentation. In addition, we can see a hint of how more fundamental discoveries grow by comparing them to ones that are more dependent on other areas, which build on work done in other fields. For example, genetics and chemistry, two areas of the basic sciences, proceed at similar rates. On the other hand, medicine and hygiene are much slower, and are also areas that rely on these more basic fields for new discoveries. Perhaps this is a hint that more derivative fields move more slowly compared to the more basic areas of knowledge on which they depend. Price's and Lehman's efforts showed that looking at how knowledge grows in a systematic way was finally possible, and they unleashed a wave of discoveries. Price's approach, looking at how science progresses by examining scientific articles and their properties, has proven to be the most successful and fastest-growing area of scientometrics. While scientific progress isn't necessarily correlated with a single publication, some papers might have multiple discoveries, and others might simply be confirming something we already know, it is often a good unit of study. Focusing on the scientific paper gives us many pieces of data to measure and study. We can look at the title and text and, using sophisticated algorithms from computational linguistics or text mining, determine the subject area. We can look at the authors themselves and create a web illustrating the interactions between scientists who write papers together. We can examine the affiliations of each of the authors and try to see which collaborations between individuals at different institutions are more effective. And we can combine the paper's citations in order to get a sense of the research a paper is building upon. Examining science at the level of the publication can give us all manner of exciting results. A group of researchers at Harvard Medical School looked at tens of thousands of articles published by its scientists and mapped out the buildings on campus where they worked. Through this, they were able to look at the effect that distance has on collaboration. They found exactly what they had assumed, but no one had actually measured. The closer two people are, the higher the impact of the research that results from that collaboration. They found that just being in the same building as your collaborators makes your work better. We can also understand the impact of papers and the results within them by measuring how many other publications cite them. The more important a work is, the more likely it is to be referenced in many other papers, implying that it has had a certain foundational impact on the work that comes after it. While this is certainly an imperfect measure, you can cite a paper even if you disagree with it, much of the field of scientometrics is devoted to understanding the relationship between citations, scientific impact, and the importance of different scientists. Using this sort of approach, scientometrics can even determine what types of teams yield research that has the highest impact. For example, a group of researchers at Northwestern University found that high-impact results are more likely to come from collaborative teams rather than from a single scientist. In other words, the days of the lone hero scientist, along the lines of an Einstein, are vanishing, and you can measure it. Citations can also be used as building blocks for other metrics. By examining the average number of times articles in a given journal are cited, we can get what is known as the impact factor. This is widely used and carefully considered. Scientists want their papers to be published in journals with high impact factors, as it is good both for their research and influences decisions such as funding and tenure. The journals with the highest impact factors have even penetrated the public consciousness, no doubt due to the highly cited individual papers within them, and include the general science publications such as Nature and Science, as well as high-profile medical journals such as the New England Journal of Medicine. Scientometrics has even given bragging tools to scientists, such as the H Index, which measures the impact of a paper on other researchers. It was created by Jorge Hirsch and named after himself, notice the letter H, and essentially counts the number of articles a scientist has published that have been cited at least that many times. If you have an H index value of 45, it means that you have 45 articles that have each been cited at least 45 times, though you have likely published many more articles that have been cited fewer times. It also has the side benefit of meaning that you are statistically more likely to be a fellow of the National Academy of Sciences, a prestigious U.S. scientific organization. It shouldn't be surprising that the field of scientometrics has simply exploded in the past half century. While Price and his colleagues labored by hand, tabulating citations manually and depending on teams of graduate students to do much of the thankless grunt work, we now have massive databases and computers that can take a difficult analysis project and do it much more easily. For example, the H index is now calculated automatically by many scientific databases, including Google Scholar, something inconceivable in previous decades. Due to this capability, we now have scientometric results about nearly every aspect of how science is done. As we spend billions of dollars annually on research and count on science to do such things as cure cancer and master space travel, we have the tools to begin to see what sorts of research actually work. Scientometrics can demonstrate the relationship between money and research output. The National Science Foundation has examined how much money a university spends relative to how many articles its scientists publish. Other studies have looked at how age is related to science. For example, over the past decades, the age at which scientists receive grants from the National Institutes of Health has increased, causing a certain amount of concern among younger scientists. There's even research that examines how being a mensch is related to scientific productivity. For example, in the 1960s, Harriet Zuckerman, a sociologist of science, someone who studies the interactions and people underlying the entire scientific venture, decided to study the scientific output of Nobel laureates to see if any patterns could be seen and how they work that might distinguish them from their less successful peers. One striking finding was the beneficence of Nobel laureates, or as Zuckerman termed it, noblesse oblige. In general, when a scientific paper is published, the author who did the most is listed first. There are exceptions to this, and this can vary from field to field, but Zuckerman took it as a useful rule of thumb. What she found was that Nobel laureates are first authors of numerous publications early in their careers, but quickly begin to give their junior colleagues first authorship, and this happens far before they receive the Nobel Prize. As one generous Nobel laureate in chemistry put it, "It helps a young man to be senior author, first author, and it doesn't detract from the credit that I get if my name is farther down the list." On the other hand, those peers of Nobel laureates who were not as successful tried to maintain first authorship for themselves far more often, garnering more glory for themselves. By their 40s, Nobel laureates are first authors on only 26% of their papers, as compared to their less accomplished contemporaries, who are first authors 56% of the time. Nicer people are indeed more creative, more successful, and even more likely to win Nobel Prizes. These regular patterns of scientists seem evident enough, at least when we look at whole populations of researchers. But what if regularities related to knowledge itself and how it's created? To understand this, we need to begin thinking about asteroids. Arthur C. Clarke was my favorite writer when I was a teenager. His visionary approach to the world around us and his imaginary futures were constructed in great detail, and they often pointed to the most positive aspects of humanity. While he is most famous for 2001, A Space Odyssey, he wrote dozens of books and many more essays and short stories. In one of his other well-known books, Rendezvous with Rama, which was published in 1973, a large cylindrical starship flies through our solar system, and a team of astronauts is sent to unravel its secrets. That starship, Rama, was initially thought to be an asteroid. However, it is detected by a series of automated telescopes known as Space Guard. These have been put into place after a meteor smashed into northern Italy in 2077, leading humanity to create a sort of early warning system for any objects that might cross Earth's path and potentially threaten our well-being. When, a number of years after the book's publication, a project like this was actually proposed, its creators paid homage to Clarke and named it the Space Guard Survey. It uses a variety of discovery methods, including automatic detection of objects in space. In addition to being a real-life incarnation of science fiction, it is also the vanguard of a whole new way of doing science, automatically. One portion of this program, known as Spacewatch, uses automated image processing to detect what are termed NEOs, or near-Earth objects. In 1992, it was responsible for the first automated discovery of a comet, which now goes by the unwieldy name of C1992J1. Automated science is being done in fields from biology to astronomy to theoretical mathematics, all using computers to make new discoveries and identify new facts. We have projects that find new species by looking at the genetic sequences in water scooped out of the oceans, and ones that allow chemists to automatically discover ways to synthesize specific chemicals. There is even a website named TheoryMine, to which anyone can go and get a novel mathematical theorem created by a sophisticated computer program that automatically generates a mathematical proof and have it named after you or a loved one. This is automated discovery combined with vanity plates. But that's not the only big thing going on right now. There is a movement known as citizen science. Everyday individuals are becoming involved in actual scientific discovery. How is this possible? The principle is rather elegant. While computers are good at lots of things, from adding numbers to counting words in a document, they are often very bad at many simple things. We are still way ahead of computers in labeling photographs or even reading fuzzy or blurred text. This computer limitation, in addition to providing a stumbling block to any robots whose route to global domination relies on caption creation, has created an entirely new field of computer science known as human computation. Simple tasks are given to lots of people to perform, often either for a small amount of money or because someone has cleverly hidden the task in a game. One of the most well-known examples of these are the distorted words we often have to read correctly in order to prove our humanity to a website. Rather than simply being an inconvenience, they are now being exploited to actually help digitize such works as the New York Times archives. By pairing a distorted known word with one that computers are unable to decipher, everyday users who can read these words are helping bring newspapers and books into digital formats. Scientists are beginning to use this sort of human computation. These researchers are relying on citizen scientists to help them look through large amounts of data, most of which is too difficult for a computer or even a single person to comb through. One example is Galaxy Zoo, in which scientists give participants pictures of galaxies to help classify them. The participants weren't experts. They were interested individuals who participated in a minutes-long tutorial and were simply interested in space or wanted to help scientific progress. Several intrepid scientists turned a fiendishly difficult problem, how to predict what shapes proteins will fold into based on their chemical makeup, into a game. They found that the best players of a simple online game known as Fold It are actually better than our best computers. Our pattern detection abilities and other quirks of how our brains work still give us the lead in many tasks that are required for new knowledge. So in truth, the facts that are changing are not changing simply without the involvement of the general population. We are part of the scientific process now. Each of us, not just scientists, inventors, or even explorers, are able to be a part of the process of creating knowledge. We are living during an auspicious time with respect to knowledge. For the first time, not only has massive computational power allowed for much information related to scientific discovery to be digitized, the amount of scientific data available online for analysis is simply staggering, but discoveries are actually occurring automatically through computational discovery, and also in a widely distributed fashion through citizen science. These combined forces, in addition to changing how new scientific knowledge is generated, have enabled us to obtain massive amounts of data on the properties of scientific discoveries and how they are found. This has led to what I, along with one of my collaborators, Nicholas Christakis, have taken to calling eurekometrics. Eurekometrics is about studying scientific discoveries themselves. More traditional scientometric approaches that use citations are still very important. They can teach us how scientists collaborate, measure the impact of scientific research, and chart how scientific knowledge grows, but they often tell us nothing about the content of the discoveries themselves or their properties. For example, rather than looking at the properties of the articles appearing in plant biology journals, we can instead look at the properties of the plant species that have been discovered. One simple example of eurekometrics, and one that I was involved in, is examining how discoveries become more difficult over time. If you look back in history, you can get the impression that scientific discoveries used to be easy. Galileo rolled objects down slopes. Robert Hooke played with a spring to learn about elasticity. Isaac Newton poked around his own eye with a darning needle to understand color perception.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.